Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Beware of the Dog, written by Peter Corris and read by Peter Hosking. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda Audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording, as well as on the web at www.belinda.com. Beware of the Dog. The dedication reads, For Professor F.C. Fred Hollows. Chapter 1. Dan Sanderson cleared his throat. Ladies and gentlemen, he said, I'd like you to meet Mr. Cliff Hardy, who has been a private inquiry agent for longer than some of you have been alive, I said. It got a laugh, but it was true. Some of the bright young faces looking at me didn't have 20 years on them, and that was how long I'd been in the business. We were gathered in a room in the Petersham College of TAFE, where I was doing a guest lecturer spot in the Commercial Agents and Private Inquiry Agents course. When I got my license, it was different. All you needed was some solid citizens to vouch for you and an insurance company to give you the appropriate cover. As a former army officer and investigator for an insurance company, I had no trouble qualifying. Now, you have to do a course in small business practice, legal principles and other things. I'm not sure I could pass it. Dan showed me the textbooks, very thick and not at all racy. But I didn't have to pass it. Instead, I was on the instructing end. I talked for about 40 minutes, giving them the spiel Glenn Withers and I had worked out. I told them about the unwritten rules of confidentiality, the necessity for good relations with the police force, the advisability of having a friend in a newspaper office, and various other shortcuts to success. I told jokes, like the one about the client who had failed his driver's license test 10 times and was convinced there was a conspiracy against him. I'd taken him seriously for a time. Then I'd stuck some L plates on my car and had him take me for a drive. End of case. And I told him about some sad ones, like the man who was sure that he was the father of his younger brother. The main thing to remember, I said in the wind-up, is that as a PEA, you are at the end of a long line. People have been let down by the law, their families, their friends, and all the authorities listed in the phone book. Often, you are a last resort. That's either an opportunity to exploit them, a reason to dismiss them, or a challenge. The choice is up to you. I got a hand. Then it was question time. Nothing very tough. Did I carry a gun? Sometimes. Did I ever break the law? Not if I could help it. How many men had I killed? Two. One in defense of someone else's life, one by accident. You should be asking me if I can name all 50 of the United States of America. A blonde woman spoke from the back of the room. You mean the work is often boring and that you have to kill time? That's right, I said. Many eyes turned towards her. And can you name all 50? Usually, I said. Time was up and the students trooped out of the room. Dan Sanderson, usually a restrained type, shook my hand. Oh, that went great, Cliff. Will you do the other class? Glenn Withers had jacked it all up. Senior Sergeant Glynis Withers, that is. She was taking a break from hands-on policing and teaching at the Sydney Annex of the Goulburn Police Academy. She had a flat in Petersham and spent 3 or 4 nights a week there. The other nights, her visits to Goulburn and my work permitting, she was at my place in Glebe. We were being very cautious about the whole thing. I had yet to sleep at Glenn's flat. She'd met Dan in a coffee shop, and they got talking about their different teaching jobs. He was a lecturer in the Commerce Department of the Petersham College, and Glenn produced a real-life private eye for his students. I'd enjoyed the lecture. Who wouldn't? Applause, appreciative young faces. Sure, Dan, I said. I could probably get you a few tutorials too, he said. Could be the beginning of a new career for you, Cliff. You're a natural. I shook my head. I don't think so. Once was fine. Twice might not be so good, and after that... Well, see how it goes. Got a rush. Thanks, Cliff. Give my best to Glenn. The cheque'll be in the mail. Better be, I growled. He laughed and hurried out of the room. I gathered up the cards I'd scrawled a few notes on and followed him. The college is a grim red brick structure that looks forbidding from the street. But the library, administrative offices and classrooms are arranged in a 3-story semicircle around a small garden. making it all surprisingly bright inside. I walked down the big windowed corridors, enjoying the atmosphere. It had been a long time since my own brief university days, and things seemed to have changed enormously. There was an air of informality that had been totally lacking in my time when we wore jackets and ties and tried to look older than we were. The students here were all ages and didn't care how they looked. "Mr. Hardy, can I talk to you?" The woman who'd twigged about the boredom component of the job was standing under an archway at the top of the steps that led down to Crystal Street. I judged her age as late 20s. She was tall and slim with a pile of blonde hair held back by a couple of combs and a velvet band. Her clothes were studentish, loose top, long skirt, boots. Her eyes were an alarmingly penetrating blue. They seemed to go right through me, out across the street, over the used car yard opposite, and up beyond the rooftops. I stuffed the cards into the pocket of my leather jacket and took the hand she held out. Smart move to stick out your hand when you want to talk to someone. Takes a double-barreled rudeness to snub you. "Of course," I said. "Miss..." She laughed. "Mrs. I'm old-fashioned. Mrs. Paula Wilberforce. Paula." She wasn't as sure of herself as she wanted to be. Her hand was smooth and warm. She looked the type to trick herself out with earrings and bangles, but the only jewellery she wore was a wedding ring. "Hello, Paula. What can I do for you?"
"Are you going to be doing any more teaching in that course?"
"Oh, I don't think so. It was just a one-off for me. Something I haven't done before. I'll do a repeat performance for the other class, but that'll be it." Her nicely shaped face fell into lines of disappointment.
"Oh, I'm sorry."
"Well, come on. At a guess, you were the smartest one there. You're not going to have any trouble getting your ticket." I glanced down at the backpack she had on the ground between her boots. It was stuffed with books and folders. "You're obviously a worker."
"I am," she said fiercely. "That's the trouble. I only enrolled in this course as a backup to my PhD.
I must have started to edge away at that point. There's something about the intensity of people who want to be doctors of philosophy that disturbs me. "Well, I'm sorry I can't help you."
She grabbed 5 fingers worth of leather sleeve. "You can, you can. You see, I'm doing my thesis on the role of the private inquiry agent in the legal system, and I'm having terrible trouble gathering material."
"I'm not surprised," I said. "We don't exactly go around shouting about our place in the scheme of things."
"No, but when I heard you talk today, I thought I might actually get something useful out of this course. You've had the experience."
"Well, that's true," I said, "but
will you at least give me an interview? A long, in-depth session to let me get a handle on how experience feeds into the philosophical..."
Well, that was enough for me. I pulled free of her and headed down the steps. "Afraid not, Mrs. Wilberforce. Professional code's against it. Sorry. Best of luck with your studies." I could feel those blue eyes boring into my spine as I walked along Crystal Street. There was something scary about her. I'd parked my car in a side street and I actually checked to make sure she hadn't followed me before I drove off. The thing is, business is slow. There's plenty of work around at the nastier end. Industrial espionage, bugging, various forms of intimidation. But the bread and butter work of summons serving, bodyguarding and money moving has shrunk. This is one of the reasons Glenn encouraged me to take on the lecturing. We were sitting in the backyard at Glebe, catching a few faint rays of June afternoon sun. For no good reason, I was having my third glass of wine after lunch. "You're underworked," Glenn said. "Is there such a thing?"
"Not for some people, but there is for you. You've got a low boredom threshold."
"Are you teaching community policing to the boys and girls in blue or psychology?"
"Don't be snaky, Cliff. Your mortgage on this place must be down to nothing by now. Business is bad. You need something else to occupy your time and energies. I'm only trying to help."
I put my arm around her as we leaned against the fibro wall of the outside laundry and bathroom. "I know you are, love, and you're right. No kids, credit cards under control, and I own the car, such as it is. There is a bit of mortgage left, though. I had to buy sin out, remember? And she hiked up the price."
"Oh, the dreaded sin," Glenn murmured. "I wonder if I'll ever get to meet her."
"Well, don't see why. I haven't met her for over 10 years. There wasn't much to say to that, but when Glenn proposed that I talk to Dan Sanderson about lecturing to his students, I couldn't think of any way to refuse. Glenn had a knack of being right in advance of me finding she was right. I was getting used to it.
As I drove to Darlinghurst, I was thinking that she'd been right again. After all, I'd enjoyed the time with the students and had been offered another spot. I could have scooted around the streets to Glenn's flat and waited for her, but we had our rules. That night we were meeting for a meal in Glebe before going to my place, and such arrangements were sacrosanct. I hadn't been into the office for 2 days, and there was always a chance that someone had slipped a note under the door asking for my help to find Lassiter's lost reef. I parked beside the church wall in St. Peter's Lane and entered the building for what must have been the 3,000th time. Stop it, I thought. You'll be counting the number of stairs you've climbed next, multiplying 58 by 3,000. You're doing it already. Knock it off. There was nothing interesting under the door, where one of the other tenants, an iridologist, shoves my mail. Well, that could mean a lot of things. The iridologist might be sick, or she might be pissed off with me for not availing myself of her services, or there just might not be anything interesting coming my way. The thought depressed me, and I sat at my desk watching the sun go down at around 4:30. It was the shortest day of the year, still 3 hours to seeing Glenn and dinner time. There was only one thing to do. I'd had one glass of red from the office cask and was thinking about a second when the phone rang. I grabbed it with relief. Hardy Investigations, Cliff Hardy speaking. I thought you might be there. You have a lonely look. A woman's voice, familiar, who? Are you sure you've got the right number? I'm sure, Mr. Hardy. This is Paula Wilberforce. I looked you up in the book. I'm sorry if I alarmed you this afternoon. You didn't alarm me, Mrs. Wilberforce. I think I did. Anyway, I wanted to apologise and to make it clear that nothing you tell me would ever be attributed to you in print. I'm simply asking for help, Mr. Hardy, like one of your clients, about whom you spoke so eloquently today. Put it down to the early sunset or the wine or the total absence of anything interesting to do beyond the few routine jobs I had on hand. The upshot was that I agreed to allow Paula Wilberforce to interview me in my office the following day at 11 a.m. She sounded pathetically grateful, but I could see her blue eyes glittering. The woman was dangerous, even over the phone. I was thinking better of it as soon as I replaced the receiver, but what could I do? The snaky side of me said that it was Glenn's fault for getting me into the academic racket in the first place. It would give us something interesting to talk about over dinner. I drew off another glass and stared through the window at the lights of the city. The angry traffic noises and the static of men and machines in conflict drifted up to me. Suddenly, I wanted to be up at Whitebridge, at Glenn's cottage overlooking the ocean with the lights of Newcastle away to the north and the sound of the waves on the beach. And I couldn't just up stakes and go, because I had Mrs. Wilberforce to see tomorrow and Dan Sanderson's second class to talk to the day after that. Oh, to hell with it, I thought. Maybe I should do a PhD. Dr. Cliff Hardy, senior lecturer in detection and personal mismanagement. The knock at my door was sharp, anxious or angry. I called out, "Come in," and stuck the glass in the top drawer. A woman entered from the gloom of the passageway. She was smartly dressed in a navy suit with a red blouse. As I eased up politely from my chair, I saw that she was wearing nylon stockings and sneakers. She saw me looking and smiled. "I'll explain," she said. "You're Mr. Hardy?" I nodded. "Cliff Hardy. Please sit down. Your name is Verity Lambert. You'd better write it down. The Lambert has an E on the end." I wrote the name on a pad and added 35, dark brown, shoulder length, wedding ring, 170 centimetres. You never can tell with women. They can change their appearance in all sorts of cunning ways. Verity Lambert was a vital, attractive sort of woman, a little too sharp-featured to be called good-looking, but with the confidence in her manners and gestures that good-looking women often have. She sat in my client chair, very composed and relaxed, with a big leather hold-all on her lap. She unzipped the bag and held up a pair of expensive-looking high-heeled shoes. "I wear these to work and take them off the minute I can." I nodded. "Yeah, I would too." She smiled. "I was told you were a wit." I was starting to like her, and to wonder if she'd fancy a glass of cask red. "Who by?" I said. "Barbara Winslow. The other reason I came in my runners is that I didn't like the look of this building of yours after dark. I've got some mace in my bag, but I wouldn't like to have to deal with some lowlife while wearing high heels." Well, I hope you locked your car. I did, and set the steering lock and the alarm. Well, that should do it. You seem to be ready for anything, Mrs. Lambert. Are you sure you need a private investigator? She put her hand into the bag and pulled out a package wrapped in brown paper. It was about the size of a thick paperback book, and it had been sealed with masking tape. The package had been opened, and the tape was now only partly holding the paper down. She slid it across the desk. Have a look at this. I released the tape where it was gripping and folded the paper back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.